فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today is going to be our first day of the explanation of the book Nukhbatul-Fikr في مصطلح أهل الأثر written by حافظ ابن حجر العسقلاني رحمه الله تعالى. إن شاء الله تعالى before we start the book there is a couple of introduction that we should take in order to understand the book Nukhbatul Fikr very well. And inshallah ta'ala, what I want to speak about is, the first thing is, in an extremely summarized manner, I want to speak about the sunnah and its position in our religion. As you are well aware of, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sent Nabiullah Muhammad as a messenger of His, the final messenger. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sent him with beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. He sent him with bilhuda wa deen al-haq, beneficial knowledge and righteous action. And the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did that is so that it can become apparent over all other things. And our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he conveyed that message in which he was entrusted with. And he fulfilled the promise and the covenant and the oath which he took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our Messenger, he fought in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until certainty came to him, i.e. death. And what our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with is two revelations. The first revelation in which he came with is Al-Kitab, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second revelation which he came with is the Sunnah. And these two, the Kitab and the Sunnah, cannot be separated. And the one who tries to separate these two will face a severe consequences in this world and in the hereafter. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to see the evidence for that. And anyone who holds on to those two revelations, the Kitab and the Sunnah, the Messenger told us alayhi salatu wasalam, that those people will be privileged and they will be honored the Day of Judgment to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam's fountain and to drink from it, and for their thirst to be quenched, and they no longer will be thirsty ever in their life after that day. Al-Imam Hakim, he narrated in his Mustadrak min Hadith Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullah, he authenticated this in his Silsila Hadith Al-Sahiha. And he also authenticated it in his Jami' al-Sahih. That the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, تركت فيكم شيئين, I have left two things with you. لن تضلوا بعدهما, you will never be misguided after those two things. كتاب الله, the book of Allah, وسنتي, and my sunnah. وَلَنْ يَتَفَرَّقَ حَتَّى يَرِدَ عَلَيَّ الْحَوْضَ. And whoever departs from this world and he dies holding on to the Kitab and the Sunnah, that individual will be privileged, he will be honored the Day of Judgment in coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hawd, the fountain of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the Prophet with. The Sunnah my beloved brothers and sisters, is hakimatun ala kulli ahadin. The sunnah, it governs everyone. It's an authority above every person. And a person's iman is null and void if they don't take on the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and if they reject it. And a person's iman is not correct if they are not pleased with Allah's law and they don't surrender to it. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 65. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ, they are truly not believers. حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ, until they make you their judgment. فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ, in the arguments and the disputes that they have. And when they make you the judgment, O Muhammad, لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجٍ, they don't find any burden or hardship in their heart towards your law and your judgment. مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا, and they surrender to it, meaning they open their chest towards your part, your law. They find انشِرَاحُ الصَّدْرِ, that they can accept it happily. So the iman is being negated here. Kamaluhu al-wajib is what's being negated here. The wajib of the person's iman is being negated. This person's iman is truly deficient. The harm that comes from opposing the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, its effects are faced in this world, and a punishment is stored for the person the day of judgment. Al-Imam Muslim narrated in the Sahih من رواية سلمة من الأكوعي أن رجلا أكل عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Al-Imam Muslim narrated in the Sahih from the riwaya of سلمة من الأكوع that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, next to him a man ate, and he ate with his left. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said to him, كُلْ بِيَمِينِكَ, eat with your right. كُلْ بِيَمِينِكَ, eat with your right. قَالَ, the man responded and he said, لَا أَسْتَطِيعُ, I am unable to do so. Then the Prophet said to him, لَا اسْتَطَعْتَ, may you never be able to do so. مَا مَنَعَهُ إِلَّا الْكِبْرَ, مَا مَنَعَهُ إِلَّا الْكِبْرُ, nothing prevented this man from eating from his right, eating with his right, except arrogance. He was able to do so. And so when he wasn't following and adhering to the Prophet's statement, when the Prophet clearly instructed him, eat with your right, and he refused to due to arrogance, the Prophet said to him, may you not be able to. May Allah take that ability really away from you. And then the narration says, فَمَا رَفَعَهَا إِلَى فِيهِ, the man wasn't able to lift his hand towards his mouth. His hand became dry. And this was a uquba and a punishment in which he got in what? In this world. This is a uquba which is ajila. It happens now in this world. And also there is a uquba that awaits for the person in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, Surah An-Nur, Ayah 62. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. فَلْيَحْذَرْ, let them be cautious. الَّذِينَ, the ones, يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ, that are opposing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command. What's going to happen to them? أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً, they are going to be afflicted with a fitna. أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ, or they're going to be afflicted with a severe punishment. Now this is a what? This is a warning, a severe warning for anybody who's opposing the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that one of two things is going to happen to you. Number one, أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ. Fitna is going to happen to you, which is going to happen in your heart. Fitna here is zayghul qalbi, the heart will deviate from the truth. And the person will become a disbeliever after he was a believer. His heart becomes tainted. The person doesn't recognize the truth, and he's unable to understand the truth, and he's unable to know the truth. He's also unable to know the falsehood, because his heart has become like a cup upside down. لا يعرف معروفا ولا ينكر منكرا. The reason for that was because he opposed the Prophet's command. Also, أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. The second severe warning is a severe punishment will happen to that person. This severe punishment can't be in this dunya. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afflicts you with what? Afflicts you with severe illnesses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also makes you come into contact with the Muslims, and they fight against you and you die on their hands, and etc. Or a punishment will await you the day of judgment. A'adab will await you. And this adab is in accordance to your opposition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. If your opposition to him is fully in the sense where you disbelieve in him, that you'll stay in the hellfire forever. And if your opposition of him is less than that, then your punishment is in accordance to that. So it's important to understand that the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is a second form of revelation. And its position in our religion is high. It holds a very high place in Islam. And the ulama, rahimahumullahu jami'an, they wrote works on this, which they spoke about the Sunnah and its position and its place, and what does it mean. And those who claim that they only follow the Quran, which is now sadly a growing group who refer to themselves as Quraniyun, Zuran wa Buhtanan wa Tadlila. They refer to themselves as those who follow the Qur'an. And this is only a form of fooling the Muslims by calling themselves the Qur'aniyun. Because we know they ain't holding on to the Qur'an. More than 33 places in the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala connects the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's obedience to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what Qur'an are they following? The Qur'an itself is what's commanding them here to follow the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's a whole different discussion, inshaAllah ta'ala, which we will designate a series for them, debunking and responding to the Qur'aniyun, those who say we only follow the Qur'an, and the doubts that they try to bring forward, inshaAllah ta'ala, we will make for it a series, inshaAllah ta'ala. The second introduction that I want to speak about is the ulama, especially the muhaddithun, they stood up to protect the boundaries of the sunnah. They made sure that the sunnah is protected. And the way they did that is in two ways. Number one, they protected its wording. And number two, they protected its meaning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He used them to protect the religion. He used them to protect the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Allah said in the Quran, "Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun." We are the ones who have sent down the dhikr, which is the Quran, and it also is the sunnah. Wa inna lahu lahafidhun, and we are the ones who are going to protect it. Surah Al-Hijr, ayah 9. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the previous nations in which He sent, He entrusted their people and their scholars to look after their scriptures. The Christians were told to look after their own scripture and to protect it from distortion. The Jews were told to do the same. As Allah says in the Quran, بِمَسْتُحْفِظُوا مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ بِمَسْتُحْفِظُوا. They were entrusted and they were told to protect their books from any distortion. As for this nation, we were informed that Allah is going to protect our religion for us, that Allah is going to protect the Quran, and that Allah is going to protect the Sunnah. And the way Allah is going to protect it is through the udul, the reliable scholars and the Ahlul Ilm. That's why there's a hadith that its sanad is Hassan, inshaAllah ta'ala, bi mujma'i turuqiha, when you bring all of its narrations together, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, يَحْمِلُ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ مِنْ كُلِّ خَلَفٍ عُدُولُهُ يَنْفَوْنَ عَنْهُ التَّحْرِيفِ الْغَالِينَ وَانْتِحَالِ الْمُبْطِلِينَ وَتَأْوِيلِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. That this religion, it will be held and it will be held up the ones who are going to protect, يَحْمِلُ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ, this knowledge is going to be carried by the reliable ones. What are they going to carry it and hold it? They're going to hold it and protect it from what? From the following. يَنْفَوْنَ عَنُوا التَّحْرِيفِ الْغَالِينَ, the distortion of the extreme one. And the tampering and the indulging of the criminal and the falsehood one. يَنْفَوْنَ عَنُوا التَّحْرِيفِ الْغَالِينَ, so they protect from distortion. They also protect it from the wrong interpretation. And they also protect it from the evil one who wants to get hold of the Nusus al-Wahyain. So this religion is protected through those people, Ahlul Ilm. They protect it by its wording, as I said, and they protect it by its meaning. And the scholars of Hadith, they refer to the two by Ilmul Hadithi Riwayah and ilm al-hadithi diraya. Ilm al-hadithi riwaya and ilm al-hadithi diraya. What does ilm al-hadithi diraya mean? Ilm al-hadithi diraya means the understanding of the ahadith and the fiqh of the ahadith, the meanings that are derived, that are extracted from the Kitab and the Sunnah, especially the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, especially the Hadith, the fiqh that's taken from it. That is known as ilm al-hadithi diraya. It's knowing the fiqh in the Hadith. Is when a person studies bulugh al-maram, when a person studies Umdatul Ahkam, and Arba'in al-Nawawi, Riyadhul Salihin, and Bukhari and Muslim and Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah and Nasa'i, all these books, you're taking a ruling from it, an ahkam, and you're taking understanding and meaning from it. The second type is known as ilm al hadith riwaya. Ilm al hadith riwaya is knowing narrations. It is knowing the narrations, and it's to know the chain and the sciences pertaining to that. The scholars, they divide ilm al hadith riwaya into two, and we're only going to be talking about ilm al hadith riwaya since we're only going to be studying Nukhbatul-Fikr. There's no need for us to talk about ilm al hadith riwaya. The first type of ilm al-hadithi riwayah is what? It is a type which is nazari, is theoretical. It is what? It is theoretical. And the second type is practical. It is tatbiqi. It is what? Practical. The type that's theoretical is what's known as mustalahul hadith. The type that is known as mustalahul hadith. Mustalah al-hadith is ilm al-hadith riwayatan, and it falls under the first type, which is nadhari. It's theoretical. You're learning theories, you're learning principles. That's why the definition Ibn Hajar gave for it is ma'rifatul qawa'id al-mu'arrifati bihali al-rawi wal-marwi. It is principles which you will know the situation of the narrator and who he is narrated from. Pay attention here. Ilm al-hadith riwayah, or mustalah al-hadith, mustalah al-hadith, ilm al-hadith riwayah, what does it deal with? It deals with the sanad and the matan. It deals with the chain, and it is also going to deal with the matan. How is it going to deal with the chain? It's going to deal with the chain basically knowing the integrity and the reliability and etc. pertaining to the narrator. And also the matan you're going to learn bi'tibari man usnida ilayhi, from the angle of who it's attributed to. Is it hadithun qudsi, this matan? Is it Allah's wordings? Is it the Prophet's wordings? Is it the wording of a companion? So is it hadith al-Qudsi? Is it hadith which is marfu'? Is it hadith which is mawquf? Or is it maqtu'? So is it the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it a statement? Or is it something that's attributed to the Prophet? Is it attributed to a companion? Or is it attributed to a tabi'i? And it also deals with the sanad of the hadith, the chain of the hadith, and that is bi'atibari wusulihi ilayna, looking at it from the angle of how it reached us. Are we all together on that? Lakin, even the ilm al-hadith al-riwayat, and that's what it deals with, it's two types. Number one, it's nadhari, you're only learning theories and principles. And that's known as what? Mustalah al-hadith, and some of the ulama call it usul al-riwayah, or they call it usul al-hadith. Usul al-riwayah is sometimes called, and sometimes they call it usul al-hadith, and sometimes they call it mustalah al-hadith. Those are terms that they give it. Mustalah al-hadith, what do you learn, my beloved brothers and sisters? You learn principles in how to know the narrators and how he narrated from him and etc. This science, which is Mustalah al-Hadith, we're going to be talking about that first, which is the Nadari first. Mustalah al-Hadith, just like any other science, it started off as different researches in different different researches, as in little researches were done about it. It wasn't a science fully, completely written. There were random units of it that were written. There were random topics of it that were written. And that's how many sciences are. They come about by random. Somebody talks about مثلا, a mas'ala in this book of his. Another one talks about another mas'ala of him here. And guess what? Later, somebody takes all of that on board and he makes a whole science out of it. He makes a what? A whole complete science out of it. Like, for example, one of the early people who had actually written in this field, who had actually spoke about it, and who had authored in it, is Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, مثلاً. But Shafi'i did not write it as a science, did he? He didn't write it as a science, Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i. There are some mabahith ilm al-mustalah in his kitab al-risala. He talks about مثلاً khabar al-wahid. He مثلاً talks about Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, the hadith al-mursal. You see? He talks about khabar and etc. Matters like that Shafi'i will deal with in his kitab al-risala. But kitab al-risala is not a mustalah al-hadith book. So you see, this is how it was at the beginning. Rather, Mustalah al-Hadith was actually, it was amalgamated with Usul al-Fiqh. It was part of Usul al-Fiqh at the beginning. And it wasn't distinguished from it. And as you know, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, he died which century? The 3rd century, he died 204. So he died in the 3rd century, in the early 3rd century in Islam. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he said, إِنَّ التَّصَانِيفَ فِي اصْطِلَاحِ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ قَدْ كَثُرَتْ لِلْأَئِمَّةِ فِي الْقَدِيمِ وَالْحَدِيثِ فَمِنْ أَوَّلِ مَنْ صَنَّفَ فِي ذَلِكَ الْقَاضِي أَبُو مُحَمَّدْ أَرَّامَهُ الْمُزِيُّ فِي كِتَابِهِ الْمُحَدِّثُ الْفَاصِلُ. Hafiz ibn Hajar, he said in Nuzhatul Nadhar fi tawdih Nukhbatul Fikr, that this science, Mustalah al-Hadith, the books that have been written in it are excessive and they are large in number. They are large and they are a lot in number. Written by the early scholars and also written by those who came after. But the first person who had written in the science of hadith as a science, not topics here and there, but rather they directed their efforts towards writing a book in science of hadith, Mustalah al-Hadith, was Al-Qadhi Abu Muhammad Al-Rama Hurmuziyu. He has a book called Al-Muhaddith Al-Fasil. Inshallah ta'ala, we're going to touch on it a little bit, bi'ithnillahi al-kareem. Hafiz al-Hadith said something very smart here. He said, فَمِنْ أَوَّلِ. He used the word min. Hafiz al-Hajar. Because he can't say that the first person unrestrictedly was Al-Qadhi Abu Muhammad Al-Rama Hurmuziyu. He can't. because it could have happened somebody that was writing it before him or had written it before him. This concept of this being the first is something very, very hard to be said, generally. Scholars, when they say that, they only say that in accordance to their knowledge. Or they base it on غَلَبَةُ الظَّنِّ, high speculation and high assumption.